Hello everyone. In today's video, I will be describing the answers to pharmacological basis type questions from the chapter of insulin and anti-diabetics. I have taken out the important pharmacological basis type questions from this chapter. So the very first, very important pharmacological basis type question is why biguanides are contraindicated or should be given with great precaution in chronic alcoholism. Now with our theoretical knowledge, we know that biguanides are oral hypoglycemic drugs and the mechanism of action through which they act is by increasing the peripheral glucose uptake and utilization of glucose. Also, it decreases the gluconeogenesis. The examples of biguanides are metformin and fenformin. Also, we know that chronic alcoholism adversely affect our liver as well as kidney, apart from other organs. Now, we are very aware of this particular pathway. Glucose is metabolized or converted to pyruvate, and this is a two-way process. This is bidirectional, and upon conversion, this pyruvate is metabolized or utilized in the tricyclic acid cycle via pyruvate dehydrogenase enzyme, and this is aerobic process, whereas another step is also there, another pathway is also there, where pyruvate is converted to lactate anaerobically, and now this is known as anaerobic glycolysis. Now metformin, what it does is that it inhibits this pyruvate dehydrogenase enzyme, and thus the utilization of pyruvate in the tricyclic acid cycle is inhibited. Now the only pathway which remains is the conversion of pyruvate to lactate. Now this is dominant, and the conversion of pyruvate to lactate is increased. Now because of this accumulation of lactate, there is the chance of lactic acidosis, and this is the reason why we should not give biguanides in chronic alcoholism. Now the manifestation like ketoacidosis, jaundice, confusion, breathing problem, fatigue and tachycardia may occur in this. The next question is why a regular insulin should be given 45 to 60 minutes before taking food. Now this timeline is varying in book to book. Some book says it is 30 to 45 minutes, some book says it is 30 to 60 minutes. So keep a safe range of 45 to 60 minutes. Now as we know that regular insulin is a soluble human crystalline insulin, and this is prepared by recombinant DNA technology. In this, zinc is added for giving more of stability to this preparation, and giving zinc, there is hexamerization occurs around this zinc. Now the difference between hexamers and monomer and dimers in its absorption is that hexamers have slower absorption in comparison to dimer and monomer. The monomers are better and the faster absorbed in comparison to hexamers. Now this conversion happens upon dilution of this regular insulin in interstitial fluid. Now this conversion takes around this much of time, that is 45 to 60 minutes. Now what happens, there are two scenarios. If we take meal before this conversion occurs from hexamers to monomers, then what will happen? There will be lack of insulin. There will be lack of monomeric insulin, so that insulin will not be able to act because of there is lesser formation of monomer, lesser availability of insulin, active insulin. So hyperglycemia may occur. Now the second scenario can be if the meal is taken very late, then hypoglycemia may occur because of more insulin is available and we are not taking food. So there will be overaction of insulin and hypoglycemia may occur. So just to reduce this chance of hyperglycemia or hypoglycemia, we should take insulin just 45 to 60 minutes before food. The next very question is, why insulin glargine? It's a type of insulin preparation. Insulin glargine is not mixed with any other type of insulin. Now, there is a structural difference between insulin glargine and regular insulin, and this differs by the position of amino acid at 21 terminal of A chain. Now in insulin glargine there is a glycine in place of asparagine, as well as there is presence of two amino acids which is attached with threonine at B chain at 30 terminal. Now insulin glargine is soluble at acidic pH of 4 instead of physiological pH of subcutaneous tissue. Other way we can say that it is more stable at physiological pH of subcutaneous tissue. Now when there is change of pH from 4 to 7.4, that is the subcutaneous pH, there will be precipitation of insulin glargine. And because of this, the release of drug is slow, and that is why it is a longer acting drug. When we give insulin in the subcutaneous tissue, there is change of the pH. Earlier, insulin glargine was kept at pH 4. Now, at subcutaneous tissue pH of 7.4, there is precipitation occurs, and then release of drug is slow, and that is why it is long acting. Now, If we mix two insulin preparation, insulin glargine is mostly kept at acidic pH of 4, whereas other insulin are kept at neutral pH. Now, if we mix beforehand or there is mixing of the syringe itself, there will be change of pH from acidic to alkaline outside itself, and then there will be loss of efficacy of both the type of insulin. So to prevent the loss of efficacy of both type of insulin, we should not mix insulin glargine with any other insulin preparation. So these are the three very very important pharmacological basis type question in the chapter of insulin and anti-diabetics. Hope it helps. Thank you very much.